Good morning. Good morning. Welcome to Parkville Presbyterian Church, a place where everyone is loved and everyone belongs. Whether you're joining us online or in person, we are glad that you're here and part of our circle today. Today we begin a new worship series, A Generous Heritage. From this Sunday until November 13th, we will use scripture as a lens to examine the past, present, and future of Parkville Presbyterian Church. This church was founded in 1845, and the cornerstone for this building was laid in 1948. As a people dedicated to God, we have a 177-year legacy, and 72 of those years have occurred in this very space. Building on the foundation of this heritage, how do we contribute to God's call now and in the future? Over the coming weeks, we'll talk about the many different contributions that we make to the holy work that's done in this space and by this people. And we'll ask you to consider your financial generosity with the church, both for 2022 as the year draws to a close, and for 2023 as we prepare a budget for next year's ministries. This effort will culminate on November 13th when we dedicate your financial pledges on a special dedication Sunday. Pledge cards can be found in each of the pews this morning. Of course, we contribute to God's work in this space with much more than financial generosity. We also contribute our time, energy, love, and prayers. This is the last Sunday of our winter clothing drive for Park University international students and others in need. But if you have used coats, new or used, coats, hats, scarves, or gloves, you can still bring them in and donate them by Friday, October 21st. Speaking of Friday, October 21st, that is the date for the next Parkville Living Center break time. On the third Friday of each month, the PLC hosts break time, an event with free food, free childcare, and an opportunity to be in community. This month is a fall festival. With a fire pit, chili, marshmallows, and lots of other fixings. It's also an opportunity for Parkview students and others in need to receive your donations of winter clothing. Please mark this event on your calendars. There's another event at the church on Tuesday, October 18th, the Parkville Living Center Town Hall. Sponsored by American Public Square, this will be an event about partisan differences and the difficulty we have in talking to one another. These days, the differences between Republicans and Democrats are so great as to feel almost tribal. How can we discover and affirm our common values and learn how to talk to one another once again? Discover more online or in person on Tuesday, October 18th. In addition to winter clothing, there are two other ongoing drives happening in the narthex. The risk-taking mission team is constructing care bags that we can give to people without homes. You can contribute to the cause by donating bottled water, personal hygiene items, or non-perishable food such as granola bars. In November, the mission team will put together the bags, and then you can hand them out to people when you meet someone in need. Our final collection this month is for Trunk or Treat. The Intentional Faith Development team is putting together a Trunk or Treat for Saturday, October 29th from 3 to 6 p.m. You can help by donating candy and giving your time on the day of the event. There is a basket in the narthex that is ready for your donations. Please see me or Molly Braun for more information on helping out. In all these events, we are expressing our heritage as a community church and living into the 177-year legacy we have inherited from our forebears. Let us discover more as we worship God together.
Please join me in the responsive call to worship. In you, O Lord, we have taken refuge. You are our rock, O God, our rock and our fortress. Deliver us, for you have been our hope, our confidence since our youth. From birth, we have relied on you, and we will ever praise you. Our God is a faithful God who delivers us in times of trouble. Our opening hymn was written by a man who knew hard times, but who learned to praise God in all circumstances. Let us rise in body or in spirit for hymn number 39, Great is Thy Faithfulness. heritage of our church is a history of faith responding to new challenges. Guided by the Holy Spirit and with Christ in the lead, PPC has lived through poverty, debt, a civil war, pandemics, and societal change. Through the gift of faith, we persevered through it all and continued to serve our community and proclaim God's love. Still, in the face of modern stresses, we often forget the gift of faith. We think the challenges we face are insurmountable, or we believe we are too small to make a difference. When we forget who we are and who we belong to, we can confess our forgetfulness to God and receive a new memory of faith. Let us confess our sins, first using the prayer printed in our bulletins, and then in a holy moment of quiet prayer. Let us pray. Lord of life and Lord of light, you are the source of illumination, who guides the steps we take. At times we forget that you are in the lead. We believe that the whole endeavor is in our hands and that it rises and falls with us. Remind us that we are yours, that you provide what we need. At times we forget the gift of faith you have given us. We believe the challenges in our way are insurmountable and that we are too small to overcome them. Remind us that we are yours, and you are the light who guides us. Help us live into the gift of faith, so that we may see you already at work. Act with courage when you act through us, and remember, we are your people. Amen. Friends, let us remember who we are. Friends, believe the good news. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. And now, as forgiven children of God, reconciled to God, and prepared to reconcile with each other, let us exchange the peace of Christ. May the peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
At this time, we invite our young disciples to come forward for a time that's just for them.
Well, good morning. It's good to see you all today. I am curious if you know what faith is.
Faith is good.
Malcolm says faith is good. Okay.
Faith is lovely.
Esme says faith is lovely. Henry, do you know what faith is?
It's kind of like hope.
I like that. Yeah, because faith is about knowing that God is there and taking and doing things that show people that we know God is there. So, for example, there may be voices in the world that tell us to not be kind to the unpopular kids because that might make us look unpopular too. Now, if we believe in God, we're still going to do that.
Dad.
Because we know that God is behind that, and that's what God wants us to do. Sometimes there are things like giving our money, and we don't want to do it because we want to keep all of our money for us. But if we believe in God, we trust that we can do that and that God's still going to take care of us. Now, Malcolm, you had a question? Yeah.
And there's a Camp Cretaceous episode called Beacon of Hope.
There's a Camp Cretaceous episode called Beacon of Hope. That's really good to know. Thank you. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, hope is an interesting, I like that definition of faith, because hope means that you trust in God enough that you'll do the thing that you're called to do. You have enough hope in God to kind of take that, to take what we sometimes call a leap of faith. So faith is basically where we have the thought in our head that God is there, we believe that, but it's also that we're willing to take the action, that we're willing to do the thing that shows that we believe in God, that shows that we can do what God asks us to do and trust that God's gonna take care of us. Esme, you wanted to say something? Esme wants to know why I need a microphone. A big part of it is because we have people online who are watching worship, and if I don't talk into the microphone, those people who are watching on their computers can't hear us.
Why don't you put the computers there so they could hear you more easily?
That's a good idea. We'll think about that some more. For now, let's say a word of prayer. God, we give you thanks for gathering us together, and thanks for giving us the gift of faith. We pray that you'll help us to act with the gifts that you give us and to show the world that we have faith in you. Amen. Thank y'all.
Above us.
Gospel of Matthew, chapter 17, verses 14 through 20. Let us listen for the word of the Lord. When they came to the crowd, a man came to him, knelt before him, and said, "Lord, have mercy on my son, for he is an epileptic, and he suffers terribly. He often falls into the fire and often into the water. And I brought him to your disciples, but they could not cure him." Jesus answered, "You faithless and perverse generation, how much longer must I be with you? How much longer must I put up with you? Bring him here to me." And Jesus rebuked the demon, and it came out of him, and the boy was cured instantly. Then the disciples came to Jesus privately and said, "Why could we not cast it out?" He said to them, "Because of your little faith. Why could we not cast it out? For truly I tell you, if you have faith the size of a mustard seed, you will say to this mountain, 'Move from here to there,' and it will move, and nothing will be impossible for you." Holy wisdom, holy words. Thanks be to God.
All right, let's see. Let me think. We'll never get out of this debt. The church's mortgage is just insurmountable. What else? I would never sleep on a cot in the library of the church while the building basically becomes a homeless shelter for the week. That's not going to happen. I can't imagine us starting a bona fide community center in the church building. That's ridiculous. I don't think it would ever make sense to have communion once a week. It would be too much work, week in and week out, and it wouldn't be special anymore. Oh, here's a good one. We could never house a woman in the church building on the youth floor for a year and a half while she recovers from homelessness. On a personal level, I could never wash someone else's feet. Excuse me, I was just making a list of things that 8 years ago many of you would have thought of as impossible, and yet they're all things that we have either done together or made great progress toward doing in the last 8 years. Amen. All right. It was 8 years and 3 days ago today that I began my new call as the pastor of Parkville Presbyterian. It was a Monday. On that first day, my office door was lovingly decorated with streamers and a welcome sign, a gift from Steve and Janet Walker, that felt very festive and welcoming. This was a symbol of the hospitality that has always been a hallmark of this church and that remains a hallmark today. In fact, in 2018, when we went through a visioning process together, we identified hospitality as the kingdom concept at the core of the church, the holy gift at the heart of who we are, and we use that to develop the tagline, "Where everyone is loved, where everyone belongs." As a pastor, it was important to me to go through a visioning process with you. It was important to me. I felt we needed a common banner to unite us. You see, when I first arrived, there was a phrase that I kept hearing over and over again. A phrase that indicated to me a marker of division and separation within the church. And that phrase was Paul's people. A phrase that indicated division. A phrase that indicated a sense that there was us over here and there was them over there and we weren't really part of the same group. For those of you who may not be aware, Paul Erickson was the organist, music director, and choir director here from 2011 to 2020. He was here for the first 5.5 years of my ministry, and I enjoyed working with him. Like me, he was an adult convert to Christianity, and we had a special bond over that. Like me, he knew the power of faith and the gift of it in a unique way because he had lived part of his adult life without it. This gave him an evangelistic spirit. He was determined to share his faith and his vision of faith with others. He's also a very talented musician. In fact, he was a piano prodigy growing up. He graduated from college at the age of 19. He As a kid, while a lot of us were developing social skills by just hanging out with other people and being kids, he was in a room rehearsing the piano. For hours and hours each day, childhood Paul was in that room rehearsing the piano. And he emerged as an adult with a virtuosic ability to play that instrument and a vision for faith that he was excited about sharing and a set of social skills that constantly rubbed people the wrong way. You hear chuckles, especially from the people who knew him well. Paul became a figure of controversy in this church. Part of this was due to his social interactions, which were sometimes mysterious and incomprehensible, and sometimes felt rude and mean. But part of it was also due to circumstances. He was here when the associate pastor left, a position that was not replaced. He was here when the youth minister left, a position that was not replaced. He was here when my predecessor left under a cloud of controversy and uncertainty. He was here when a lot of changes were happening that we did not ask for and did not want. He was here when a number of our friends left the church. And some people pinned the blame for all of these changes on him. If he weren't so flashy, if he was less visible during worship, if he were kinder in his social interactions, this would all be better. And one manifestation of this thinking was to refer to Paul's people. There were people who were attracted to the church because of Paul. Some of them had been with him in previous churches he had served. Some of them sang in the choir. Some of them were not even involved in the music program. They just loved him and his work. They became involved in the life of the church. They joined the church. They helped with Sunday school. One of them started editing the monthly newsletter and still does. And those were the adults. Others were young people, vocal students of his, who practiced their developing skills in worship on Sunday morning. After a few years here, Paul stopped accepting money for music lessons and just asked his students to come on Sunday morning. All of these people are all special people who were growing in faith under Paul's direction, but for some, they were simply Paul's people. For some, this group was temporary, devoted only to the personality of a figurehead, and they would be gone as soon as he was, like so many other of the church's close friends who had also been driven away. In my view, the truth of it was more complicated. I think that Parkville is a special place. I think that's true of both our church and of this town, but I'm referring specifically to the town at this point. How many small towns do you know with a thriving main street like ours? How many small towns have a bustling downtown? Not many. Those are things of the past in a lot of places. Downtown Parkville represents the hard work of many entrepreneurs, and it also represents the spirit of a place that is a bit more old-fashioned than other parts of society. A place that is more willing to hold up tradition and to keep the spirit of community alive. There are a number of trends that happened in other parts of American society first, and then in Parkville later, because this is a place that holds on to the old ways a little bit longer. And so one of those late-breaking trends that came to us later than it did elsewhere was church decline. The kind of decline that this church experienced from 2010 to 2020 is the kind of decline that other churches experienced between 1980 and 1990. Compared to 2010, we're about half the size we used to be. The budget is lower as well. As the pastor who has presided over many of those years, I have felt those losses. When a person leaves the church you pastor, it feels deeply personal. Sometimes it is personal, and on a rare occasion, the person leaving will even admit to that. And that stings, but at least it's honest. What I'm getting at here is that there's dynamics on a micro level and on a macro level. If we're looking at the big picture, we see that Presbyterian churches in all places are experiencing lower membership, lower budgets, lower enthusiasm, and the pandemic only exacerbated those trends. On a micro level, we can talk about the dynamics within our particular church. We can talk about staff members who offended people. We can talk about my predecessor and the controversy there. We can talk about how hard the last pastoral transition was between him and me. We can talk about all the micro stuff. That stuff is real and it matters and it's very much part of our story. And we can also talk about the macro stuff, the national trends. In our larger society, people are less religious than they used to be. People are less likely to identify themselves as Christians. And if they do, they're less likely to attend church because they think they can commune with God as individuals and without the help of a community, as though you could lop off the hands and feet of Christ and still have Jesus Christ. These national trends may have impacted Parkville decades after they impacted other places. We may have experienced from 2010 to 2020 what other churches went through from 1980 to 1990. But that only means that the wounds are fresher. The pain of it is more raw. All right, have I depressed you enough? I'm not really supposed to be this honest about our internal struggles, about the feelings some of us feel, about my own struggles with all of this. But I'm leaving you at the end of the year, so I can be more honest than I'm supposed to be. Truth is, this church is facing strong national headwinds. This church is facing changes in society that are wide and far-reaching and detrimental to churches, and it is doing so from a weaker position than it was in 12 years ago. All that is true. We are facing a mountain of a challenge. And what are we going to do in the face of a mountain? Are we going to give up? Are we going to pack it in and say, that's too hard? We can't scale that mountain. Or do we have faith the size of a mustard seed? Because Jesus said, if you have faith the size of a mustard seed, you will say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it will move, and nothing will be impossible for you. Today, the church is facing a mountain, but we have the power to move mountains. In some ways, this church has been moving mountains for 177 years. In that long history, we've lived through pandemics, plagues, a civil war where people were shooting at the church spire and using it for target practice, a debt in the 1870s that seemed insurmountable, and yet the church somehow found a way to get through it. God has been behind this endeavor. God has been with this witness to the love of God in the heart of Parkville for 177 years. And even in the face of what seemed like impossible odds, there has always been faith the size of a mustard seed to move the mountains that needed to be moved. Let's look at the past 8 years of moving mountains. In the past 8 years, we've added 68 new members. In the past 8 years, we've added 68 new members. We haven't kept all of those people. Some of them came here, joined the church, and then moved away again, because that's the reality for young families in our mobile society. But the fact remains, 68 members in 8 years. That is proof that people are out there. People are out there longing for connection, longing for community, longing for spiritual tradition. Despite the national trends, people are looking for a church like this one. We just have to work harder to find them and to connect with them, and we have to learn how to attract them without losing the people who are already here. That may seem like a lot of work to do and a hard balance to find, But if you have faith the size of a mustard seed, you can move mountains. In the past 8 years, we've rediscovered a sense of church unity. I bet it's been a few years since you've heard anyone use the phrase Paul's people. We don't have cliques or subdivisions in our church. We're all united under the banner where everyone is loved, where everyone belongs. To forge this unity, we use small groups, fellowship activities, visioning, and a sense of common mission and working together on mission projects. We banded together to overcome past resentments and uncertainties and to come together as one people. Now, at one point that may have felt impossible, but if you have faith the size of a mustard seed, you can move mountains. When I arrived in 2014, the church's mortgage debt felt insurmountable. In 2004, we borrowed $3.5 million to expand this building. And 10 years later, the debt stood at $2.8 million. In 10 years, we had paid off 20% of the mortgage. The first few years of a church debt are supposed to be the best years for fundraising. Those are the years when the project has just been completed and it feels new and exciting. The years after 2014 should have been the hardest years for us to retire debt. But instead, you have faithfully pledged your financial gifts year in and year out, and you faithfully responded to the capital campaign we ran from 2016 to 2018. And now the debt stands tantalizingly close to $1 million. Those were a lot of numbers that might have been hard to follow. Let me put it a different way. In the past 8 years, we paid off 2.5 times more debt than we had in the first 10 years of the loan. In the past 8 years, when fundraising should have been the hardest, we paid off 2.5 times what we did in the earliest years when fundraising should have been the easiest. That's amazing. That is practically unheard of in the world of church mortgages and finance. And that is a testament to your faith, to faith the size of a mustard seed which can move mountains. What else have we done together? We have always had a great mission team in this church, but in the past 8 years, they have become even more active and loving. We revived our tradition of caring for Park University international students through welcome kits that provide needed items when they first arrive in our country. We started a new tradition of writing Christmas cards for veterans in the hospital. While the organization was active, we joined Family Promise of the Northland. We were part of a network of churches that opened their doors to the homeless, providing 1 week of shelter and meals about 4 times a year or once a quarter. Some of you were overnight hosts, sleeping on cots in the church library, while our Sunday school rooms became a homeless shelter. 8 years ago, I don't imagine any of you would have ever thought of such a thing. But with faith the size of a mustard seed, we can move mountains. Speaking of shelter, during 5 of the 8 Christmases that I've been here, there has been a person living in the youth room. Different people, usually. But 5 out of the 8. There's just something about the Christmas season for me. During pre-pandemic times, the kids were on winter break and youth group wasn't meeting. And then I would meet people who needed a place to stay, something more than just a night or two in a hotel. And it was Christmas, and it was cold. And we were reading a story where a transient family was told that there was no room at the inn, and if we had a room we could let people in need use, how could we turn them away? Recently, we welcomed a woman into the youth room for 1.5 years. She came in the middle of the pandemic when the room was not in use. We didn't intend for her to stay that long, but it turned out that she needed 1.5 years to recover from the trauma of homelessness and to experience the love of a church and to get back on her own 2 feet. 8 years ago, I imagine all this would have seemed impossible. And in fact, I've never seen anything like it in a church. But with faith the size of a mustard seed, we can move mountains. I could go on. I could talk about the new things we're doing in worship. I could talk about church life and the pandemic and how we managed through 2 years of worshiping online and outside. I could talk about the Parkville Living Center. All things that we could not have imagined 8 years ago, but with faith the size of a mustard seed, we can move mountains. And so today we're anticipating, we're about to undergo another pastoral transition. We worry that the church will flounder without clear leadership. We worry that without a full-time installed pastor, we will be without direction. But we are not going to be without direction. The church is going to have you, the members of the church. You are the leadership that the church really needs. And with you at the helm, nothing will be impossible. With faith the size of a mustard seed, you can move mountains. Amen. Let us rise in body or in spirit to sing our responsive hymn, number 73, Give Thanks for Those Whose Faith is Firm. As we come to a time of prayer, a reminder that we are reviving a tradition of the church, that after each request, I will say, Lord, in your mercy, and you will say, hear our prayers. What joys and concerns do we have to lift up to God this morning? Yes, Jan? We give thanks for a successful surgery for Carl Myers, for his continued recovery. We pray that God will continue to be with him. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. For what else might we? Yes, Sandra?
I'd just like to say another prayer for Susan Heim Davis,
the minister. Yeah. For Susan Heim Davis, who's been in a long recovery from a series of falls and some other ailments, we pray for her continued recovery and strength. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Hey, yes, Randy?
I have a friend who will go on name who's struggling with some personal issues, trying to figure out what the priorities are in his life, and I'm just asking for
prayer. A friend struggling with personal issues and looking to find priorities in life.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Yes, Jill? For a tragic shooting at a daycare center in Thailand, for shootings everywhere, domestic and abroad, we pray for God to help us find some meaning in the midst of what seems like senseless tragedy, and we pray for God to comfort those who are desperately in need of comfort. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Mary, did I see you earlier? No. Doug? Shirley. Shirley Broad, you said?
Brock.
We pray for the family of Shirley Brock, both that formal family that is connected to her biologically, but also that informal family who knew her as well. Shirley was a friend of the family of Doug and Debbie Walker and a second mother to Debbie. We pray for those who are mourning her loss. We pray for God's comfort in their grief. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Carrie? The people of Ukraine and the people of Iran, people who are struggling for liberty, people who are in turmoil, we pray for God to bring them peace and justice. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Marcia? We pray for the Parkville Living. We pray for the Parkville Living Center and its efforts to bring people together, people who are not always of like mind, but people who are very much in need of community and seeing one another. We'll mention specifically here that as the Parkville Living Center prepares for its town hall on Tuesday, there have been two instances of candidate forms being set up, and in both of those instances, the Republican candidate has withdrawn from the forum. We are concerned about what it's like to be in a society where we can't at least talk to each other, where we can't at least sit down with each other and talk about the issues that are important to us both. And so that's become the focus of the town hall on Tuesday, is facilitating conversations, being together. It sometimes feels like we're further apart than ever. And we certainly need the Holy Spirit to draw us in. So Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Rosemary? Rosemary will be part of a panel discussion this week on domestic violence and other forms of violence in the home. We pray that God will be with her to guide those words and to help her to convey a holy message that conveys the light of God. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Carrie? Carrie mentions that it's Pastor Appreciation Month, and she expresses thankfulness for me, which is very nice of her, and I appreciate that. Of course, Carrie is a pastor as well, and so she gets to be appreciated too, so how about that? Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Yes.
I pray for rain for our parched earth.
We pray for rain for our parched earth. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Jan? Thank you, Jan. So Jan lifts up the transitional work that we're doing as a church and my role as a pastor in that transitional work and the role of our session in that transitional work. I would just mention briefly that today's sermon was part of that, because part of what it means for a church to transition is to tell the story of where we've been and who we are. And so what you heard was sort of my entry, and this is what I feel like the story of the past few years have been. You might disagree with that telling of the story. If so, let's talk about it. And that's part of the transition work too. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Yeah. Yes. Victoria Abrahamson is having knee surgery on the 21st. We pray for her care team and pray for her recovery. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Let us continue in prayer. God, we give you thanks for drawing us together. We give you thanks for the life that you breathe into us at the beginning, for the spirit that holds us together as a community, for your forging of a people of faith in this place and time. We pray that we may continue to faithfully live out your call and your vision. We pray that we may continue to treat one another with love and continue to embrace one another in the spirit you have called us to embrace one another. We pray that you will continue to forge us as your people, as individuals, and as a group, that you will bring healing to those who need healing, that you will help the rest of us to be healers, and that we may always follow in your way. We ask this in the name of your Son, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. On the Thursday before the Sunday, when he rose again, Jesus had supper with his closest friends. During a moment in that meal, he lifted up a loaf of bread and he said, This is my body, which is for you. As often as you share bread together, remember me. In the same way, he took a cup and poured it out, and he said, This is the cup of the new covenant, sealed in the substance of my life. As often as you share this cup together, remember me, for I will not share it with you again until we meet in the kingdom of heaven. I would invite the servers to come forward at this time. And as they do, I would remind all of us that this meal was offered to a community of people who were the very same ones in our scripture reading, who weren't sure that they knew what to do, who weren't sure that they had the faith to do what needed to be done,
In our scripture reading this morning, we heard about a person who wanted healing for a son, and the disciples couldn't do it. And Jesus said, "It's your faith. Do you have faith that you can institute this healing? Do you have faith that you can bring it about?" They weren't sure that they could do it. They felt like they themselves weren't enough. But Jesus says that in fact you are enough. And that is why I love you and fill you and call you forth. And so in that spirit, let us now come forward.
Parkfield Presbyterian Church has stood as a witness to the love of God since 1845. But when the cornerstone of our building was laid in 1948, we were known as Parkfield Community Church. At the time, we had members from many denominations in a variety of walks of life, and we still do. Today, the church is one of the rare species of common ground in our society, where Republicans and Democrats, liberals and conservatives, and people of all races, classes, and identities can find a place. If preserving this space is important to you, please contribute to its upkeep through a gift in the offering plate or through one of the means listed in your bulletin. You can also make a financial pledge for 2023 by placing a card in the offering plate or sending a card by mail to the church. However we give and whatever we give, may all of our gifts be used for God, by God, for love, service, and praise.
Mm-hmm.
Let us pray. Lord, we lift these gifts, along with our whole lives, up to you. May we remember that we are yours and follow where you would have us to go. Amen. Today we give glory to God, who gives us the gift of faith and sends us forth in his name. Let us sing our final hymn, number 641, When in Our Music God is Glorified.
Moving mountains is not just a thing they did long ago, it is a thing we do today. Go forth in faith and move mountains. Amen.